Hello and welcome back. In the first four videos of this tribulation series, we saw how Jerusalem was destroyed as Jesus foretold almost 40 years before it happened. In this video, we will take a closer look at Matthew chapter 24 and see what other things Jesus foretold. Let's read Matthew chapter 24, starting at verse 1. It says, "And Jesus was going out of the temple and going away, and his disciples came to him to draw his attention to the buildings of the temple. But he answered and said to them, 'You see all these things, do you not? Truly I say to you, in no way will even one stone be left here on another that will not be thrown down.' And as he was sitting on the Mount of Olives, the disciples we know were Peter, Andrew, James, and John, they came to him privately, saying, 'Tell us, when will these things be, and what will be the sign of your coming and the end of the age?'" Notice that the disciples' first question was a when question. When will these things be? In verse 3, they wanted to know when the temple would be destroyed. As Jesus said, not even one stone would not be thrown down. Jesus in Matthew chapter 24 seems to ignore their question about when this would happen to the temple. So he didn't really answer their question in Matthew the 24th chapter, but he did in Luke's account in Luke chapter 21, verse 20, where Jesus says, "But when you see Jerusalem surrounded by armies, then know that her desolation has drawn near." Notice that Jesus didn't give them an exact day or time, but he said, "Know that her desolation has drawn near." So Jesus here in Luke answered their when question, and that Christians should take action to flee the city. In verse 21 he says, "Then those who are in Judea must flee to the mountains, and those who are in the midst of her must leave. And do not let those who are in the country enter her, because those are days of vengeance to fulfill all that is written." We know this occurred in 66 AD when Cestius Gallus' army surrounded Jerusalem and then suddenly left, giving Christians the opportunity to leave the city. The disciples' second question was a what question. They asked Jesus, "What will be the sign of your coming and the end of the age?" So they had actually asked him two different questions there. They wanted to know what signs would mark his return and the end of the age. The disciples were not ignorant of the fact that Jesus was going to die, because Jesus told them so in Matthew several times. First, he mentioned it in Matthew the 16th chapter, starting in the 21st verse. It says, "From that time Jesus began to show his disciples that he must go to Jerusalem and suffer many things from the elders and chief priests and experts in the law, and be killed, and the third day be raised." Verse 22, "And Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him, saying, 'Be it far from you, Lord, this will never, ever happen to you.' But he turned and said to Peter, 'Get behind me, adversary. You are a stumbling block to me, because you do not have in mind the things of God, but the things of men.'" Then again in the Matthew, the 17th chapter, again he mentions that he would die. This was just after the transfiguration. Verse 22, "And while they were gathering together in Galilee, Jesus said to them, 'The Son of Man is about to be handed over into the hands of men, and they will kill him, and the third day he will be raised.' And they were deeply grieved." Again a third time in Matthew, the 20th chapter, Jesus spoke about his death. Verse 17, "And as Jesus was going up to Jerusalem, he took the 12 disciples aside privately and said to them on the path, 'Pay attention, we are going to Jerusalem, and the Son of Man will be handed over to the chief priests and experts in the law, and they will condemn him to death and will deliver him to the Gentiles to mock and to scourge and to crucify him, and the third day he will be raised.'" So the disciples knew that Jesus would die and be raised up again. Just a few days later, after Jesus was killed, all of the disciples saw him with their own eyes. This account is in Matthew chapter 28, starting in verse 5. It says, "And the angel answered and said to the women, 'Do not fear, for I know that you are looking for Jesus who has been crucified. He is not here, for he has been raised, just as he said. Come see the place where he was lying, and go quickly and tell his disciples he was raised from the dead. And look, he is going before you into Galilee. You will see him there. See, I have told you.' And having departed quickly from the tomb with fear and great joy, they ran to report about him to his disciples. And look, Jesus met them, saying, 'Greetings.' And they came, took hold of his feet, and paid homage to him. Then Jesus says to them, 'Do not be afraid. Go tell my brothers to go away to Galilee, and they will see me there.'" Down in verse 16, it continues, "The 11 disciples went to Galilee to the mountain where Jesus had directed them. And when they saw him, they bowed before him, but some doubted. And Jesus came to them, spoke to them, saying, All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Therefore, go and make disciples of all the nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, teaching them to obey all that I commanded you. And remember, I am with you always, even to the end of the age." So here Jesus mentions the age that the disciples were asking about. After Jesus rose from the dead, he was present with his apostles and a large number of others. Paul refers to an occasion when he appeared to 500 people at one time. This is mentioned in 1 Corinthians, the 15th chapter, starting in the 3rd verse. He says, "For I delivered you as of first importance that which also I received, that Christ died for our sins according to the Scriptures, and that he was buried, and that he was raised on the third day according to the Scriptures, and that he appeared to Cephas, then to the 12. Then he appeared to more than 500 brothers at once, most of whom remain alive until now, but some have fallen asleep. Then he appeared to James, then to all the apostles, and last of all, as to one untimely born, he appeared to me also." So during the 40 days following his resurrection, Jesus gave many proofs to the apostles that he was alive. However, the disciples were still not very clear about when Jesus would rule in Israel. They really had no idea at this stage how Jesus' rulership would unfold, because in Acts chapter 1, their question proves this lack of understanding. Acts 1 verse 6 says, "Now when they had come together, they asked him, saying, Lord, is it at this time you are going to restore the kingdom to Israel?" The disciples likely knew of Daniel's prophecy in Daniel chapter 9, that there would be a period of 490 years, or 70 weeks of years, from the rebuilding of Jerusalem after the Babylonian captivity until the time of the Messiah. I will be discussing this prophecy in Daniel chapter 9 in more detail after we finish with Matthew, the 24th chapter here. They may well have thought that the fulfillment was near and expected Jesus to rule in Jerusalem at that time. From their thinking, they had been under tribulation for a long time under the Persians, the Greeks, and now during Jesus' time under Roman domination. They looked at the Roman oppression as a time of tribulation, time of difficulty. So from the disciples' perspective, they thought Christ would rule in Israel and set up his kingdom right away. But Jesus corrected them in Acts 1st chapter and verse 7, where he says, "And he said to them, It is not for you to know the times or dates that the Father has set within his own authority." Jesus mentioned this to his disciples before on the Mount of Olives in Matthew the 24th chapter verse 36, where he says, "But about that day and hour, no one knows, not the angels of heaven, nor the Son, but the Father alone." This is just another verse that puts another nail on the coffin for the Trinity, because according to the Trinitarian doctrine, supposedly God and Jesus are co-equal. But obviously, the Father, Yahweh, knows things that his Son, Jesus, does not understand. Only Yahweh alone knows the day and the hour of the end of this system or wicked age. Acts chapter 1 verse 9 mentions the ascension of Jesus into heaven. It says, "And when he said these things while they were watching, he was taken up, and a cloud received him out of their sight. And while they were looking into heaven as he was going, look, two men stood by them in white apparel, who said, Men of Galilee, why do you stand looking into heaven? This Jesus who was taken up from you into heaven will come in the same way as you saw him going into heaven." So returning to Matthew chapter 24, the disciples wanted to know the sign of when Jesus would return when they asked the what question. What will be the sign of your coming and the end of the age? And so Jesus began a long explanation of many signs that would take place on earth just before his second coming. But the disciples also asked about the end of the age. Well, the end of what age? Matthew, the 25th chapter, answers that question for them in verse 46. Matthew 25, we'll start in verse 41, where it says, "Then he will also say to the ones on the left hand, Depart from me, you cursed, into the fire of the coming age." Remember that fire is always a symbol for complete destruction, not eternal torment. Anyway, he refers to the coming age, he continues, "which has been prepared for the devil and his angels. For I was hungry, and you did not give me anything to eat. I was thirsty, and you gave me no drink. I was a stranger, and you did not invite me in. naked, and you did not clothe me, sick and in prison, and you did not visit me. Then they will also answer, saying, Lord, when did we see you hungry or thirsty or a stranger or naked or sick or in prison and did not serve you? Then he will answer them, saying, truly I say to you, insofar as you did not do it to one of these least, you did not do it to me. Verse 46 here it says, and these will go away into the punishment of the age to come, but the righteous into life in the age to come. The Greek word aion, spelled A-I-O-N, or age, occurs 128 times in the Greek manuscripts of the New Testament, and it is used in the Bible, depending on the context, to have the following two meanings. One, a period of time that never ends, meaning forever, everlasting, or eternal. Or the second meaning, a period of time that begins and ends, meaning an age or age lasting. There are only two ages Jesus referred to. The age we live in and have for the past 6,000 years or so is referred to in the Bible as the evil age, the one in which humans have lived from the time that Adam and Eve sinned against God and brought a curse upon mankind. Jesus' death on the cross brought us hope to one day be saved from this evil age by shedding his blood for all mankind. Jesus' millennial kingdom rule will put an end to this current evil age or aeon forever. So this evil age must eventually come to an end. The age that Jesus spoke about here in Matthew chapter 25 was not the end of the Jewish age that occurred in 70 AD, but was something much more meaningful for all mankind. This current evil age will end when Christ returns and begins his reign on the earth after destroying all man-made governments. As Jesus said in Matthew 28:19, therefore, go and make disciples of all the nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, teaching them to obey all that I commanded you. And remember, I am with you always, even to the end of the age. Well, it's pretty clear here. Jesus was talking about the end of this present system. Preterists try to say that Jesus was speaking about only the end of the Jewish age there in 70 AD, but they have that dead wrong. The age Jesus spoke about was the age of his kingdom taking control of the world, where the judgment of the righteous and the unrighteous will take place. The Bible is very clear about that will take place when Jesus appears in his second coming. Jesus didn't have in mind only his disciples either in his day, but he gave predictions of his second coming for the benefit of all Christians throughout all the centuries to follow, so that we in end times will understand clearly when Jesus' kingdom is drawing near. The term preterism comes from the Latin praeter, which is a prefix denoting that something is past or beyond. Adherents of preterism are known as preterists. Preterism teaches that either all or a majority of the Olivet Discourse had come to pass in 70 AD, and that was just the end of it. Well, we know that Jesus didn't return then in 70 AD, so that is the major flaw in the preterist view of Matthew chapter 24. Jesus mentions the age to come again in Matthew the 12th chapter, verse 32. It says, and whoever speaks a word against the Son of Man will be forgiven, but whoever speaks against the Holy Spirit will not be forgiven, either in this age or the age to come. So this age is referring to this evil age we've been living in for these 6,000 years. The age to come refers to the kingdom of God. Paul mentions the present evil age in Galatians chapter 1. Galatians 1 verse 1 says, Paul, an apostle, not sent from any group of people, nor through any person, but through Jesus Christ and God the Father, who raised him out from among the dead, and all the brothers and sisters who are with me to the churches of Galatia, grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ, who gave himself for our sins to deliver us out of this present evil age, according to the will of our God and Father, to whom be glory forever and ever. Amen. At the end of the age, literally the consummation of the age, the present evil system will be put out of the way forever, and a far more glorious age will be ushered in during the millennial reign of Jesus Christ. So very clearly, Jesus was not referring only to the end of the Jewish age that occurred in 70 AD. He was referring to the age where the righteous will live forever and the wicked will be punished. This, of course, will occur during the reign of Jesus Christ. Again, as Jesus said in Matthew 25, verse 46, and these will go away into the punishment of the age to come, but the righteous into life in the age to come. So in the millennial reign, that's when the judgment of people takes place there. The Revised English Version Bible says this regarding this verse. The punishment of the age to come. This is the punishment in, or perhaps even better, associated with or of the age to come, i.e. the Messianic age. The simple understanding of this verse has been obscured by Orthodox Christian tradition. The context and scope of Scripture support the translation and primary emphasis of the phrase as it is translated in the REV Bible. The punishment of the age to come, and not eternal punishment or everlasting punishment or age-long punishment, all of which have an emphasis on duration. The primary emphasis of the punishment in this verse is that it will occur in the age to come when Jesus rules on the earth. During that future age, the righteous will be rewarded and the unsaved will be punished with eternal death, not eternal torment. So they make that clear explanation of that, what that age means and when it takes place there. Moving on then. So Peter, Andrew, James, and John had their questions answered by Jesus as to when Jerusalem would fall and what the many signs would be of Christ's return and what age Jesus was referring to. The disciples, obviously, at that time on the Mount of Olives, could not comprehend all the aspects of Jesus' signs and when they would occur because, as we read earlier in Acts chapter 1, the disciples still were not clear if Jesus was going to set up his kingdom right away after his resurrection. Actually, even Jesus didn't fully know the time of his return because only the Father knows the day and the hour, as Jesus told his disciples in Matthew 24, verse 36. Many of the signs Jesus spoke about did apply on a small scale to Jerusalem's destruction in 70 AD as a minor fulfillment, but the main focus of Jesus' prophecies was about his second coming and the signs associated with it, as we learned that he was speaking about the end of the age just before his kingdom rule begins. There are two major sections to this portion of Scripture in Matthew 24. Number one, the destruction of the temple and the fact that Jesus predicted it. And number two, the signs of the times of the end of the age, or the flow of history until the return of Christ. According to scholars, there are 1,845 references to the return of Jesus Christ in the pages of the Bible. In fact, references to the second coming outnumber references to the first appearance of Jesus by an 8-to-1 margin. Jesus' return is highlighted in 17 Old Testament books, and within the 27 New Testament books, there are 321 mentions of the second coming. In part 2 of the 24th chapter, Jesus teaches us about his return on the clouds, but we will get to those verses later. For now, let's continue our reading in Matthew 24. After verses 1 through 3, where Jesus answers the disciples' questions about when Jerusalem would be destroyed and what would be the sign of his return in the end of the age, now that we know that Jesus' focus was on the signs of his return or his second coming and the end of this present evil world, Jesus continues on in verse 4 as he starts to discuss the signs associated with his return. So we'll pick that up in verse 4 there. It says, "And Jesus answered and said to them, see to it that no one misleads you, for many will come in my name, saying, I am the Messiah, and will mislead many." From the first century all the way to the 21st century, there have been people who claim to be Jesus Christ. In more modern times, names like Jim Jones and David Koresh and others come to mind. Jesus warned the disciples that many would also be deceived. One example of this is in 1846 when a false prophet named William Miller predicted the return of Christ. When it didn't happen, there was great disappointment along with many being deceived, just as Jesus warned, and many fell away from their Christian faith. There have been many religions that have made prophecies about the end coming, such as the Jehovah's Witnesses' many false dates for the end times. Many Christians have been stumbled because they have made the decision to follow men and believe these things. As I try to prove on this channel, following men always leads to disappointment. Verse 6, Jesus goes on, "And you will hear wars nearby and reports of wars far away. See that you are not frightened, for these things must come to pass, but it is not yet the end. For group will rise against group and kingdom against kingdom, and there will be famines and earthquakes in various places. But all these things are the beginning of birth pains." The total number of military and civilian casualties in World War I was about 40 million. Ranking it among the deadliest conflicts in human history. World War II was much worse, An estimated 70 to 85 million people perished in that war, which was about 3% of the 1940 world population at the time. Deaths directly caused by the war, including military and civilians fatalities, are estimated at 50 to 56 million, with an additional 19 to 28 million deaths from war-related disease and famine. As hard as it may be to believe, the Great Tribulation will make these numbers pale in significance, as the Bible speaks of the amount of people who will be killed in Revelation chapter 6, starting in verse 7. Here it mentions that a fourth of the earth's population will be destroyed. Verse 7, it says, "And when he opened the fourth seal, I heard the voice of the fourth living creature saying, 'Come.' And I saw, and look, a pale horse, and the one who sat on him, his name was Death, and the grave was with him following. And there was given to them authority over a fourth of the earth to kill with broadsword and with famine and with death and by the wild beasts of the earth." There are about 8 billion people alive on the earth today. That means that the fourth seal alone will take 2 billion lives, leaving 6 billion remaining. But then in Revelation chapter 9, during the fifth trumpet of Revelation, it mentions that another third of mankind will be killed. Revelation 9 verse 15, "And the four angels that had been prepared for the hour and day and month and year were released to kill a third of mankind." So of the 6 billion that were left, another 2 billion more will be killed during the fifth trumpet blast of Revelation during the Great Tribulation. Now we can understand why Jesus said in verse 28 that all these wars that seemed so great during the past 2,000 years are just birth pangs leading to the great slaughter of the Great Tribulation. Jesus continues on in Matthew 24 and verse 9. He says, "Then they will hand you over to be tortured and will even kill you, and you will be hated by all the nations because of my name." Jesus said that a slave is not greater than his master in John 15. I'll read that right now in 15 verse 18. It says, "If the world hates you, you know that it hated me before it hated you. If you were of the world would befriend you as its own. However, because you are not of the world, but I chose you out of the world, therefore the world hates you. Remember the word that I said to you, a servant is not greater than his Lord. If they persecuted me, they will persecute you also. If they kept my word, they will keep yours also." 21 says, "But all these things they will do to you on account of my name, because they do not know the one who sent me. If I had not come and spoken to them, they would not have had sin. But now they have no excuse for their sin. Whoever hates me hates my Father also." There's another Trinitarian verse. Jesus has a Father. He isn't the Father. Christians have been persecuted in one way or another for many centuries, but this will be especially true during the reign of the Antichrist, as the scriptures predict will occur during the last 3.5 years of the Great Tribulation. We will be studying those verses in Revelation very soon, so stay tuned for that. True disciples of Jesus should expect to be betrayed, hated, and persecuted, even by some of Christians who have fallen away. Many professing Christians will stumble, and the apostasy will be great. Again, during the Great Tribulation, it's foretold that there will be a great following away of Christians as they are fooled into worshiping the Antichrist. Anyway, Jesus goes on in Matthew verse 10, where he says, "And then many will fall away, and they will hand over one another, and will hate one another. And many false prophets will arise, and will mislead many. And because of the increase in lawlessness, the love of the many will grow cold. But the one who endures to their end, this one will be saved." Verse 14, he says, "And the good news of the kingdom will be proclaimed to the whole inhabited earth as a testimony to all the nations, and then the end will come." In the time of Jesus, the gospel was confined to a relatively small number of people in and around Israel, and much of the earth's landmass was completely unknown to the disciples of Jesus at that time. So the odds of the disciples preaching the kingdom gospel throughout the whole world was quite impossible back then. 2,000 years later, the gospel is preached in every nation. The Bible is translated in hundreds of languages, and the gospel of the kingdom of God is being spread throughout the earth via radio, cable TV, satellite, and the internet. Still, there are many who have not heard about the kingdom of God, and the Bible speaks of a time when even the angels will be involved in this preaching work before the end finally comes upon this planet. In Revelation 14, it mentions this in verse 6, And I saw another angel flying through the sky, carrying the eternal good news to proclaim to the people who belong to this world, to every nation, tribe, language, and people. Fear God, he shouted, give glory to him, for the time has come when he will sit as judge. Worship him who made the heavens and the earth and the sea and all the springs of water. So despite all the tribulation to come, including obstacles and resistance to the spread of the good news, the message will reach every part of the globe. Revelation also mentions two witnesses who will be preaching during the tribulation period for a global witness. That's mentioned in Revelation 11:3-12. It's a description of the two witnesses who will be made up of Jewish and Gentile Christians who will help accomplish God's work during the tribulation. It says in Revelation, there I will appoint my two witnesses, and they will prophesy for 1,260 days, or 3.5 years, clothed in sackcloth. The Bible identifies who these two witnesses are. This is a prophecy that we will be looking into soon when we get into the book of Revelation. God will use every powerful means at his disposal to make sure the kingdom message is preached throughout the earth to give warning to all mankind before the end comes. Moving on in Matthew 24, we come to the 15th verse that speaks about the abomination of desolation. Verse 15, therefore, when you see the abomination of desolation that was spoken of by the prophet Daniel standing in the holy place, let the one reading understand. In the records of Jesus' teaching, he only once used the name of Daniel here in verse 15, the abomination of desolation. We find that in Daniel, the 11th and 12th chapter. We'll be discussing that also very soon. But in AD 70, the Roman army was an abomination in that period, as we saw with Titus offering sacrifices to his false gods in the temple. This happened before, when Pompey in 63 BC did the same thing. So Titus was a minor fulfillment of this prophecy of an abomination, but Jesus gave a hint of an abomination which will occur close to the end of the age of this wicked system in Daniel, the 11th and 12th chapters. In these chapters, Daniel is speaking of the last days of this evil age just before the return of Christ. So Jesus directs us to seek out Daniel's prophecy regarding the times of the end. Jesus' main focus was not the temple in 70, but the end times temple and the man of lawlessness, the Antichrist who is yet to come during the seven-year tribulation. I will backtrack and cover this prophecy also after we finish with the 24th chapter of Matthew. Jesus continues on in verse 16, then those who are in Judea must flee to the mountains. The one who is on the roof must not go down into the house to take things out, and the one who is in the field must not turn back to take his cloak. But woe to those who are pregnant and to those nursing in those days, and pray that your flight is not in the winter nor on a Sabbath. So these verses apply to the Christians in 70 AD in a minor fulfillment of Jesus' prophecy as they fled from the city after seeing the Roman armies surround Jerusalem in 66 AD, as we've already discussed. The Jews who ignored Jesus' warning did the opposite. They ran into the city on the Sabbath and paid dearly for ignoring Jesus' words with their very lives. In the major fulfillment of this prophecy of Jesus, many Christians in the future will flee from the persecution that the Antichrist will bring on Christians, as Revelation speaks about the Antichrist trying to destroy God's people at the midway point of the seven-year tribulation period. The seven-year tribulation is the time period when all these prophecies Christ gave us in Matthew 24 will occur all at once on a global scale. We've seen wars and earthquakes and famines in the past as birth pangs, but now all these things will occur within the seven-year tribulation period. The last 3.5 years are called the Great Tribulation that Jesus speaks about in Matthew verse 21, where he says, for at that time there will be great tribulation such as has not been from the beginning of the world until now. No, and it will never, ever happen again. The coming seven-year tribulation will be worse than all the wars of the past combined, and worse than all the famines and pestilences and natural disasters that have occurred in the past. The 21 plagues of Revelation released onto the world during the seven-year tribulation period will be the worst time that has ever befallen mankind. Thankfully, once these plagues are over, the millennial reign of Christ will begin, and never will such horrors ever again come upon mankind. God is taking the world back away from the Gentile ruling nations. The nations will never surrender their power to God willingly. God has given the nations of this world plenty of time to prove that man cannot rule himself without his Creator, and any who stand in his way will perish in this never-to-be-repeated Great Tribulation. The destruction of the Great Tribulation will be so bad that if God did not cut short the days, no one would be saved. As is mentioned in verse 22, it says, "And if those days were not shortened, no flesh would have been saved, but for the sake of the chosen, those days will be shortened." So God will cut short the days on account of his chosen ones, those who are a part of the new covenant, who refuse to accept the mark of the beast in the end times. Jesus continues on, Matthew 24, verse 23, where he says, "At that time, if someone says to you, 'Look, here is the Messiah,' or 'Here he is,' do not believe it. For false messiahs will arise and false prophets, and will show great signs and wonders so as to mislead, if possible, even the chosen ones. Look, I have told you beforehand. Therefore, if they say to you, 'Look, he is in the desert,' do not go out there. Or, 'Look, he is in the inner rooms of the temple,' do not believe it. For as the lightning goes out from the east and shines even to the west, so will be the coming of the Son of Man." So Jesus' coming will be a powerful event witnessed by the entire world. It will be like lightning flashing across the sky all the way from the east to the west. Jehovah's Witnesses teach that Jesus came silently in 1914, but there will be nothing silent about Christ's return. The Bible says that every eye will see him in Revelation 1 verse 7. "Look, he is coming with the clouds, and every eye will see him, even those who pierced him, and all the tribes of the earth will mourn because of him. So will it be. Amen." The Watchtower Organization, Jehovah's Witnesses, have fostered a lie about this date, 1914, for over 100 years. This date was a false date based on Charles Russell's false prediction of the return of Christ. When that prophecy failed, many left that religion in those early years because of this false prophecy. The Watchtower Organization turned that lie into another lie that Jesus somehow came silently in the year 1914. The Watchtower has set many false dates over the years for the end of the world. Some of the dates were 1925, 1935, many times in the 40s, and then in 1975, where many Jehovah's Witnesses fell away from their religion because it didn't come true again. The Bible assures us that there will be nothing silent about the return of Jesus Christ at his second coming. In Jesus' day, a false prophet was put to death. So it's a very foolish thing to try to set dates for the time of Jesus' second coming. But some religious organizations never learn from their mistakes, sad to say. There are many Christians today who believe that the rapture of Christians will occur before the Great Tribulation. This teaching is called the Pre-tribulation Rapture. This idea has been around a long time, but it is not supported in Scripture. Notice what Matthew 24, verse 29 says about the timing of the rapture. It says, "But immediately after the tribulation of those days, the sun will be darkened, the moon will not give its light, and the stars will fall from heaven, and the powers of the heavens will be shaken. And then the sign of the Son of Man will appear in heaven, and then all the tribes of the earth will mourn, and they will see the Son of Man coming on the clouds of heaven with power and great glory. And he will send out his angels with a loud trumpet blast, and they will gather together his chosen ones from the four winds, from one end of heaven to the other end of it." So clearly here, Matthew verse 29, the rapture of Christ's chosen ones on the earth will occur after the tribulation, not before it, like the pre-tribulation rapture teaches. The tribulation will be a time of great testing for God's people, and many will have to die during this harsh period. The false teaching of a pre-tribulation rapture is a dangerous teaching because Christians need to prepare themselves to endure the Great Tribulation and be ready to give up their lives for their faith if they have to. I think the pre-tribulation is more wishful thinking than anything else. This rapture of God's people occurs at the seventh trumpet, as mentioned in Revelation chapter 11, where it says in verse 15, "And the seventh angel blew his trumpet, and there were great voices in heaven saying, 'The kingdom of the world has become the kingdom of our Lord and of his Christ, and he will reign forever and ever.' And the 24 elders who sit before God on their thrones fell on their faces and worshiped God, saying, 'We give you thanks, O Lord God, the Almighty, who is and who was, because you have taken your great power and reigned. And the nations were enraged, and your wrath has come, and the time for the dead to be judged, the time to give the rewards to your servants, the prophets, and to the holy ones, and to those who fear your name, both the small and the great, and to destroy those who destroy the earth. Well, clearly here, Christ returns after the tribulation is over. When Christ returns, then he raptures his ecclesia, or church, to himself. Both those who have been asleep in death and those Christians who have survived the tribulation period until Christ's return will be raised up to meet Christ in the air, as stated in 1 Thessalonians chapter 4. Starting in verse 14, it says, "For since we believe that Jesus died and was raised, so also we believe that through Jesus God will bring from the grave those who have fallen asleep, so that they will be with him. For this we say to you by the word of the Lord, that we who are alive, who are left until the coming of the Lord, will certainly not precede those who have fallen asleep. For the Lord himself will descend from heaven with a loud command, and the voice of a ruling angel, and with the sound of the trumpet of God, and the dead in Christ will rise first. Then we who are alive, who are left, will be suddenly caught up together with them in the clouds, for a meeting with the Lord in the air, and so we will always be with the Lord." So the Bible's pretty clear that the rapture of God's chosen ones occurs after the tribulation is over. Okay, that's all I have time for today, so I'm going to end this video here. In my next video, we will finish up Matthew, the 24th chapter, and then we will take a look at those chapters in Daniel, chapter 9, the prophecy regarding the 70 weeks of years, and then we will look into the abomination mentioned in Daniel, the 11th and 12th chapters. So there's lots of deep research to do. So stay tuned for all that, and thanks very much for watching.